بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. جناب حسیب درابو صاحب, جناب عمران انصاری صاحب, جناب انیل کیتان صاحب, جناب مختار چایا صاحب, جناب پرویز صاحب, جن کے بینک ادر ڈگنیٹری, گڈ ایوننگ, السلام علیکم. ایٹ دا آؤٹ سیٹ فرسٹ آئی ووڈ لائک ٹو اپولوجائز آن بہاف آف مائی آنریبل چیف منسٹر. He has started, I think, only a few minutes back from Jammu, and I don't think he'll be able to join us tonight. My apologies to all the dignitaries and guests here. Nevertheless, we'll try to fill in the blanks and try to speak on. I have my elder brother and the finance minister who is here to show us the way forward, for which we have come here and for which we would like to thank the PhD Chamber. I thank the organizers of this significant event for inviting us to address this August gathering of ambassadors, high commissioners and commercial economic counselors of various countries to talk about our state, Jammu and Kashmir. Our diversity of almost continental proportions, from the arid deserts of Ladakh to the greenest Asian valley of Kashmir to the subtropical Jammu region, is a distinction that in our view can be harnessed as a great potential for the state's overall socio-economic growth. Unfortunately, Jammu and Kashmir has not been able to attract even 0.5% of the total live investments made by both governments and private sectors across India, despite the state having immense scope in sectors like small and medium enterprises, food processing, horticulture, education, textiles, tourism and hospitality. IT, ITs, information technology enabled services, BPO business, and other potential industries. Government is the major investment source in J&K, evidently, as 1.3% of the total investments made by the central government across states was put in J&K, while the state attracted a meager 0.3% of the total investments made across India by the private source. Gentlemen, while the frontline states in India are competing to attract domestic and foreign investors, J&K, on the other hand, could not attract any major foreign investment, but for one which recently Dr. Drabu, with his personal efforts, I would say, did sign with the government of UAE. To get our state and our people back on course and leap forward to an area of peace and prosperity, I believe it is time to define what we want Jammu and Kashmir to look like 20 years from now. One of the major challenges in the conflict-ridden states like Jammu and Kashmir is connectivity, the lack of it and the need for it. I am in absolute agreement with the former president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam's vision of connectivity, which is fourfold: physical connectivity, economic connectivity, knowledge connectivity, and emotional connectivity. All these four aspects are interrelated and mutually enforced. Therefore, the major task for us is to connect to the larger world outside, through road, rail, air, and last but not least, through knowledge. Institutions of learning like universities and colleges need to link up to the knowledge centers throughout the world to draw upon knowledge and experience for learning. Trade and business must become outward-looking through better connectivity. Fruits of sweeping changes taking place as a consequence of globalization and liberalization will not reach the grassroots until there is a people-to-people and people-to-institutions connected around us. Greater cultural contacts would create emotional bonding amongst the people and weaken the forces of ignorance. It is our strong belief that awareness through better connectivity will lead to economic empowerment through a better appreciation of choices and opportunity and through rational and informed decisions. In societies like ours, emerging from conflict, young people have a crucial role in peace building and economic stability. They can make use of new technologies to bring about change. Young people have demonstrated the potential to build bridges across communities, working together, helping to manage conflict and promote peace. Young people are vital stakeholders in conflict and can be agents of change and provide a foundation for rebuilding lives and communities, contributing to a more just and peaceful society. In any case, In J&K, people aged from 15 to 30 years account for a staggering 39% of total population, compared to approximately 30% normally. No thinking society can afford the marginalization of its young people who account for such a large population. Even in a limited electoral sense, the age group of between 20 and 30 years accounts for 57% of the population eligible to vote. Thus, notwithstanding anything, the sheer demographics make youth the most important segment in political economy of J&K. The youth have to be equipped with the skills needed in the modern day job market to not only earn livelihood for themselves, but create employment opportunities for their counterparts as well. That is exactly why we are here with you. With a literacy rate of 68% against the national average of 74%, J&K has a long way to go. Our Jammu and Kashmir is not the only state where education is free. Up to the university. Apart from government efforts, the voluntary sector should be encouraged to augment educational infrastructure in this. The kind of a violent conflict that we have gone through has deeply affected our as a whole and our youth in particular, but experiences, vulnerabilities, and coping mechanisms. Young people have been particularly affected by the collapse of education and employment opportunity. At the same time, the conflict has brought about change in social norms and opened up opportunities to renegotiate relations and hierarchy based on age. We have to make sure that the new alternative structure is more inclusive of the youth in post-conflict recovery. Ignoring such process of social change can lead to dissatisfaction, alienation, and distrust in the benefits of this specific situation of a post-conflict scenario. The state's youth have increasingly singled out as a target group, deserving specific attention. The rationale for this is linked to preventing violence and or reinforcing based on the underpinning assumption that youth can be both a threat, peace, and a force for. For us in J&K, economic development will be determined by the ability of local people to mobilize resources to address local. Youth are in a position to be among the stable and long-term contributors that help guide the process. And I seek cooperation of PhD. In the realm of education, we shall have to promote universal access to quality higher and secondary education by encouraging regular school attendance and reducing dropout due to economic factors, besides inculcating innovative and creative skills and technical vocational training according to students. We have to design an education system that is relevant both to the needs of youth and to their potential employers by conducting a thorough review of the existing formal education system and assessing its relevance and compatibility to the needs of the young people across the state. It is imperative for us to reorient the educational system towards various vocations to minimize the problem of mismatch between the demand for and the availability of skilled manpower, and to provide an alternate to those seeking to pursue higher education without a particular interest or purpose. My colleague was just speaking about the availability of youth for IT sector. I think the language test, what you normally do in when you start a BPO, I think Kashmiris should top amongst in the English speaking language, at least I would say. Serious efforts are essential for diversion of a sizable portion of secondary pass outs to the vocational streams. In the process, befitting prioritization of vocational streams like agriculture, food processing, IT, tourism, health and paramedical services, commerce and engineering, and maintenance of quality must be ensured. Youth unemployability is more serious a crisis than unemployment. The discontinuation of education leads to accumulation of job seekers in the bottom of the education pyramid. And the immediate fallout of this is the low skill levels among the working population. It goes without saying that our youth are simply unemployable, as 90% of employment opportunities require vocational skills. This becomes critical, as nearly 90% of jobs in India are still skill-based, with the bulk of employment coming from agriculture and other related activities. When we talk of PhD's role, this is where it exactly fits in. We shall have to consider new ways to involve youth and allow them to offer input during decision-making, problem-solving, and action-taking activities. Active collaboration with youth will engage them in ways that will open doors for them to contribute. The state government has taken a modest endeavor to introduce vocational education program in the state, we have about 20,000 enrollments in various states covering about more than 300 schools. I would request your participation to supplement our effort so that this is a further, this is further scaled up to create opportunities for our budding youth while pursuing formal education in different areas and for extending their employability. In light of this scenario, let me share with you that education in J&K is witnessing a rapid transformation. Its capital city, Srinagar, Jammu, are emerging as knowledge hubs in North India. The state is gradually becoming an educational hub with establishment of universities and institutes of national importance like IIT, IIM, and NIT. Our government is keen to set up more educational institutions in the state. Earlier, priority was on accessibility of education, but now the priority is shifted to quality of education. The economic revival in J&K has to be oriented around strength and potentials. Such an orientation will overcome the weaknesses as well as threats to economic stability. The guiding philosophy should be that business of government is governance, not business. The government should play the role of a catalyst, a facilitator, but not of a player in the economy. And we are ready to play that role and invite you to strengthen our hands in being the people who bring in investors who come and invest there. Today, on behalf of the J&K government, who has been working and dreaming really big new dreams for our people, we are asking for your support, for your partnership, and for your confidence to help us move forward and consolidate on the enterprise of hope for the people of Jammu and Kashmir. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.